Should I begin?
Yeah, just
okay, well,
sorry.
That's fine. Well, first of all, greetings to our keynote speaker, Dr. Stephen Dick from Karlsruhe, from the whole city and from the ZCOM, and we look forward to your visit at some point in the future. And thank you, Alexander, for a wonderful playlist of speakers. I've been following your emails for the past months, and you've really built what I consider a fascinating group of thinkers and historians and practitioners in space art. I'm just an artist, so I'm sort of peripherally involved. Your knowledge is probably much deeper, and your knowledge of space history and cosmology and all of this is probably much more profound than my own. We are involved in several projects that relate to space art at the ZCOM. Dr. Weibel, who also sends his greetings to you all, he's in America lecturing today. We are basically working towards the possibility of launching or somehow accessing a satellite with the purpose of course, cultural and peaceful utilization of near-Earth orbit. It's art from the very beginning has been looking for space, whether it's a riverbank or a cave wall or sand in the desert. And then after art found spaces, it became about space, about the space of text, about the space of perception, and so on. And now we feel that it's time for art to be not only about space, but in space. And SpacePlace is kind of a survey, a very broad survey of how various artists from various disciplines, interdisciplinarily, have been looking at outer space. Now, as an artist, we, like scientists, we model the world, and it's very interesting to hear Dr. Dick, as a historian of science, kind of bring these two modeling systems together in his talk through the idea of imagination, and of course the entire conference from Dr. Geppert as well, this idea of imagining. That's basically what we do as artists. We build machines that imagine. Whereas scientists will model something to solve a more pragmatic problem, we basically look for machines that will produce pictures, meaningful pictures. So for us, here in this project, SpacePlace, we are doing a survey of what sort of pictures people have produced since Galileo. Here we have, of course, Konstantin Tsiolkovsky, who was referred to in our keynote speech, who I believe this is the first drawing of human weightlessness. You can correct me, of course, I'm not a historian, but my research on Wikipedia, which is not always precise, as we heard from Dr. Geppert, led me to that conclusion that this is the first drawing of human weightlessness. You see on the top left what's known as a gotchi. We made a gotchi also for Konstantin, who is actually an active member of this blog. You can visit his profile as if he were alive. It's submitted by him as well. He has a Google Mail address, and so on. So it's an art project. We're playing with this idea of Web 2 and identity in cyberspace and so on. And why not, if Van Gogh is in a sense still alive, and if there is such a thing as cultural memory, then why not? Just allow ourselves this poetic license. On the left, that's a user who uploaded a picture from their mobile phone in Munich to this particular site. I guess he or she was responding to the drawing here and found something in the environment of downtown Munich that reminded them, and you can upload an image. You'll see this out in the hallway. Heiko, my colleague, who actually is our gotchi maker. He's the one who found all of the artist portraits and made these lovely gotchis. This picks up on a trope in the internet from places like Planet KDE and Planet Suzy and all the Linux planets, where the profile pictures of the hackers are called hacker gotchis. So we decided we would make artist and scientist gotchis for our people because they kind of look like aggregates. And that brings us then to the tag cloud of the project, which then, that's Peter Weibel right here, by the way, showing up. This is basically like what's called a delicious tag cloud that we have turned into a visual tag cloud. We've taken the keywords for various areas of interest, math or moon or science fiction, and we have then varied the size of the gotchis depending on the number of entries in that field. And then if you click, say, on this field, you'll see, well, there's Jacques Tati, and that's Louis Bunuel and Chien du Loup with that famous scene of the moon being passed by a cloud and an eyeball being sliced. And then you can pick through various entries. This is Jacques Tati, for example, a scene from his movie Traffic, which involves the moon, the famous moon landing from the Americans at the end of the 60s, which we also heard about. You can see there have been several people who have uploaded to this particular node images of themselves. This is the archive web-based version of the double screen public installation that we have outside, which is run by some mobile phones. Now, as we know, most of us don't even know how to use our mobile phone, so Heiko can show most of you and save you the stress of pulling out your instruction manual to find out where your Bluetooth is and if you have the JSR 82 appy installed with your Java midlet and so on, because as it is right now, technology in mobile areas is still a little bit difficult for the normal human beings. Now, SpacePlace, it owes its name to the movie, of course, Space is the Place, and here a short clip from Sun Ra. Now that basically speaks for itself. The idea of a space for place or a place for space that Sun Ra is playing with here is, of course, of great interest to a lot of artists. We are as well dealing with the idea of orbit. Our model, our art model, is based on the concept of orbit. Now, orbit for us is the elementary unit of space. It's sort of the millimeter. If you think of electron orbits or how one measures space at all, we've taken the orbit as this idea of a fundamental unit. And we're looking at what we call orbitization, which is based on an idea that we kind of think that perhaps perhaps now globalization is a done deal, that it's something that is bought and sold, that orbitization is now the new environment for globalization, which is no longer our environment. You know, that globalization is condensed out of the environment and become a product, like a shipping container that can be bought and sold. So what is the environment for the global? And of course, then we came up with the idea of the orbit. So we thought of orbitization and art in the age of orbitization. I can read you just from a very early paper that Peter and I put together on this, one or two paragraphs from this Spiegel cover. The environmental paradigm shift from globalization to orbitization is illustrated on a recent cover of the German Spiegel magazine. Hovering a bit above page center, it shows a shipping container cube on which the image of the Earth's surface is texture mapped. Not only the globe, but also globalization has become a marketable commodity to be bought and sold, often through cryptic orbital channels in an invisible marketplace, closed to many and overseen by supra-orbitant bodies, usually the military. This transportable cubic globe on the cover hangs suspended by chains and a crane hook, balanced against a black sky above a horizon below which appears a stark moonscape that uncannily calls to mind planet Earth, perhaps a future zombie Earth. So when you look at the pictures that are out there in the public domain as to how we imagine our Earth, it takes me to then this wonderful, much more happy image by Piero Manzoni. And this is his Socle du Monde, which is very close to the Tycho Brahe Observatory, I believe, in Denmark. Now, he's turned the entire Earth into his sculpture. That's his pedestal, his Sockel, and he's written the text. He's used a very simple device of inverting the typography so that the entire Earth is resting on his pedestal. You see? So he's basically turned the Earth into this abstraction, which is what our Canadian pundit Marshall McLuhan said broke our bond with planet Earth. It was when we first saw an image of our planet from space that Earth became outer space itself. That this aesthetic image of seeing the planet, it became any other heavenly body with pristine blue seas and pure white cloud cover, untouchable, invulnerable, always clean and perfect. Never could it be destroyed by humankind or by any sort of pollution or mishandling of the environment, because it just looks so perfect, like every other heavenly body. So it's this abstraction of the Earth that happened with photography that Piero Manzoni is commenting on rather wryly or ironically with his Socle du Monde, and he's taken, I mean, as we stand here today, we're like apples hanging from a tree somewhere on his sculpture, which is on his pedestal, and his pedestal is resting on orbit. And he dedicated this piece to another very important precedent for us in putting together this this curatorial work, and that's the famous text by Galileo from 1634, I think, or 1632, Two Chief Systems of the World. Now, there's an interesting quote from De Santayana from MIT back in the 50s, and this is also from our preparation paper that we wrote a couple of years ago. It was not Galileo's astrophysics and math that led directly to his imprisonment during the Inquisition. Ironically, it was a play, Galileo's Socratic dialogue from 1632, titled A Dialogue Concerning the Two Chief Systems of the World, that infuriated the Pope enough to place him under house arrest. After all, mathematics was rated at the time as a thing for technicians. Quote, MIT professor Giorgio De Santayana posits in his book The Crime of Galileo in 1955. Galileo's dramaturgical choice of a Socratic dialogue encouraging readers to reflect and think independently and critically was far more potent publicly than any virtuoso display of abstract mathematical reasoning could be at the time. Galileo's dialogue convincingly and playfully revealed before all the world the needless absurdity of a dogma upholding a geocentric worldview, which effectively making his E pur si muove, and yet it does move argument in favor of Copernicus' heliocentric worldview, with no loss of mythology and delight, and the common sense gains such acceptance would meet science, technology, and culture. Ironically as well, it was the same invention that Galileo went partly blind peering through to empirically substantiate Copernicus' view from his 1543 treatise Revolutions of the Celestial Orbs, namely the telescope or spyglass, that soon after its invention turned its optical gaze with the speed, turned its optical gaze back on us from space to center on humankind as we tend or like to place or see ourselves. With the speed of a couple of centuries, telemedia have placed Earth again at the center of another virtual geocentric or geocentroid world scheme, a telematic universe starring planet Earth, orbited by surveilling spyglass satellites, shining stand-ins for planets, Fox and CNN, competing with Venus and Mars for media attention, Sky TV acting as an ersatz Jupiter, day and night. Namjoon Paik, a TV art pioneer, said it best, titling a TV installation from 1965, Moon is the Oldest TV. I mean, that's where you took your boyfriend or your girlfriend out back before they had television, and you'd look at the full moon. It was, you know, that was something that you did, so it was the first TV. And we'd go back to Galileo, who actually, in my view, invented television. And this is the first, in my view, the first film animation, and what a subject, to take the sun itself. This is, some of you are probably aware of his sunspot drawings that he did daily, at the same time every day, over a summer period, in 1613. And he must have had an animation in mind, because he basically, at the same time every day, his assistant, I believe, worked out the system, so although he did destroy his eye partly from looking at the sun, he made a movie. The first film in history, in my opinion, is this 1613 animation, and what a subject for the medium of light, the sun itself, Galileo Galilei. And there are other sort of artistic anecdotes that I can mention to you. For example, as a model maker, we try to reduce things to their essence when we make an art piece. And this artist is a Russian installation artist. This is part of a sequence of installations that he's done. He's done other pieces as well. They're in our archive on the ZCOM server. And this is a lovely title. You can see it was made in 1968 and then reconstructed in the 90s in the Beaubourg in Paris. And this is from Ilya Kabakov, the man who flew into space from his apartment. You'll notice that there's a hole in the ceiling, and he has a very dramatic light in the museum shining through that hole, and he has sort of political portraits and a catapult system and some belongings, and then of course it's dealing with this entire Cold War era of space travel at the end of the 60s. And one thing that he said, which is for another piece that he made in Münster here in Germany, which is an antenna piece where he has very fine text in between the antenna wires that are barely readable. So it almost feels as if it's being transmitted. And he said, who does not wonder when they look up? In a sense, all space art is about that simple human action of just look up. If you just simply, the phenomenon of looking up is enough to bind all of our various cultural backgrounds together to imagine an outer space. So this again, there's a lot of inspiration to be had from artists who work with notions of space and outer space and near-Earth orbit. Here is the earliest example that I could find of a vimana. I believe that's Sanskrit for celestial car. And it's written in the famous Indian epic, which Peter Brook, by the way, you can read it on YouTube or look at it on YouTube, the Mahabharata. And there's an artist's illustration with the... You know, I have to add that my dad is an aeronautical engineer, and he was with Norbert Wiener when he was 16 in MIT back in the 40s. And so I grew up doing test flights on planes and things like this. So I have a little bit of an interest myself from my childhood in space through my father, actually, and computers, not through my father, but through my mother, who taught herself Unix when she was 55. Does library science and library loans and is kind of a hacker, a security expert. She's now 82 and still very fit in computer technology. And so I have a little bit of this in my family background, and this is the earliest where Arjuna, this protagonist, in the... it's a very interesting story that he was a warrior prince and what's called a human monad, which to me is a Leibnizian term, which means a symbolic individual. Apparently he embarked on a vimuna, which is a celestial car, soaring up in a blaze through cloud cover into deep, dark outer space. Now this is 2,500 years before now, or before the present. These are a few of the various things. There's 430 entries on SpacePlace. I will show you just one or two. There was something to do with the Hiroshima moment in history that related to this particular play by Bertolt Brecht. Perhaps one of you can remind me. As an artist, I usually remember things in pictures. I go through so much information, I tend not to remember all of the historical dates and details. I remember things more visually. But this is an interesting quote from Bertolt Brecht about das Weltall hat über Nacht seinen Mittelpunkt verloren und am Morgen hat es deren unzählige, so dass jetzt jeder als Mittelpunkt angesehen wird und keiner. And here is a little clip from Donald Rumsfeld with Charlie Rose, talking about orbitization without really knowing that he's talking about orbitization as the envelope for globalization. You know, as an artist, again, we think very simply, a globe is basically a geocentric model. You have a center point and an aura. That's it. the force field. That's what a globe is. A television tower is a perfect sculpture that says globalization. You know, but orbitization is more of a translocal phenomenon than a global. It's more like a mesh or a provisional network of connections that forms over the surface of the Earth between different communities for different times. And this is what, of course, was a huge problem for the Rumsfeld regime.
And I want to talk about a lot of issues to make a speech about the role of the media and its impact. Tell me what you want to say.
Well, that's close, but really what the talk is about is the fact that this is the first war that's been fought and conducted in the 21st century in the new media environment where there are cell phones and Blackberries and
emails
and 24-hour talk radio and 24-hour news programs and the internet and blogs and all of these things that move information near instantaneously all across the globe, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
So what he's saying is there that this kind of translocality, which is what the internet is about, it's often confused with globalization and mass media. The internet is a very different situation formally from television, for example, but it's often lumped in with CD-ROMs and DVD-ROMs, which are read-only memory systems. They're archiving systems that emanate from a central source, and it's a very provisional, temporary, translocal source, and it has a power that can act as a check and balance on some of the inequities of globalization. And of course, we're looking to try to find a way to at least have a voice in orbit for the peaceful and the cultural shared space of orbit, that it's not simply a centralized, controlled system. That can take us into a couple of other... for example, one interest in space is what President Johnson said in 61, control of space means control of the world. And of course then with the Soviets in the lead in the Cold War in space travel, at least to a certain extent, the Americans got almost every nation to sign a peaceful treaty for the use of outer space. We opened the show in Munich on the day that the United Nations convened in Vienna for their conference on the peaceful use of outer space. So we opened last year in Munich on the same day. So now you hear General Ashi, 1996, it's politically sensitive, but it's going to happen. Some people don't want to hear this, and it sure isn't in vogue, but absolutely, we're going to fight in space. And then, just last year, the US Space Commander-in-Chief, space superiority is not our birthright, but it's our destiny. Now, there's a treaty for the peaceful and cultural use of outer space, and although one can sort of try to eliminate the political or the polemic from a socio-cultural look on outer space, it's really difficult to completely eliminate it. So I don't want to focus too much on that, because I know the purpose of this conference is more about the sociology and cultural uses of space, but it's still something that should be said, that there is a militarization process going on in orbit that ought to be looked into and dealt with fairly and with unity among nations. Now here's a quote from Peter Weibel, who, no matter what you research in media art, it turns out that he's done it 20 years before you. So this is this is from 95, but he did it also in 85 when I was researching, and I'd find quotes from him about shows on orbital art and so on. And here he's talking about the emptying out of space, the space of telecommunication, and how that we're developing an orbital view of things, and that this changes our whole notion of scale, and that continents will become stamps, and the globe will become just a single point. And this is the current installation of SpacePlace in ZCAM at the moment, in a show called User. And this is a very famous work of space art. It's from Andy Warhol and Robert Rauschenberg and Klaus Oldenburg, a lot of really fantastic pop artists from the 60s, making very minuscule works to send to the moon. And here is another work by an American artist, Ron Jones, the bed Neil Armstrong slept in his first night back from the moon. Plays wonderfully with the idea of not only of fetish, space as fetish, but also just where does utopia rest? Or it's kind of an object for projecting this whole dreamlike idea of space travel, the bed that Neil Armstrong actually slept in on his first night back from the moon. You know, that's really quite a wonderful object. He's now teaching in Europe. He's up in Norway. And here's a more mimetic. There's a lot of space art that's very mimetic of the astronauts' experience. There's a whole group of people around Leonardo, and there's a couple of curators that deal with space art that's very much about a literal reading of space from an astronaut's point of view. But this is a rather fun zero-gravity, I guess they call it parabolic flights, where you lose gravity for a certain period by... someone sort of playing with the idea of the flying carpet and this very expensive space apparatus for. And here's another piece by an artist in London where she collected a lot of industrial parts. I think the bottom, it says it's from a toothpaste factory. And she spent time finding them, and she built up this huge artificial rocket in London, also with the Arts Catalyst group, who are very interested in space art and support artists working with peaceful and cultural uses of space and sound, video and sculpture and so on. And she's done some really wonderful work. This is our, when we upload to the site that I showed you with Tsiolkovsky, it's also generating automatically for your web phone a pared down version. So we've been now serving web phones for a couple of years with SpacePlace, and this is some flying saucers from some Chinese artists at the Venice Biennale in 2005. It's based on a farmer's vision of flying saucers. There's a lot of artists from Asia that are also working with issues of space art. Here's a German fellow, Michael Selsdorf, who's made some really wonderful stuff, and of course the Wilson sisters also doing a lot of photography and good work that relates to our notions of space. This brings us to the point here. You know, Joseph Beuys said that everyone is an artist. So now in a mobile world, perhaps everyone has become a satellite. When I walk around the room here with my handy, my cell phone, maybe I'm a sort of a satellite with a 1 meter altitude. So what we've built now, I don't know if this is going to load, the computer was smelling awfully hot, but if I try to load Second Life, we've built a satellite that tours the mainland of Second Life without any borders. And we reverse things. Normally, when you think of building a satellite, you think of a vehicle that you climb in, like a car. And then when we did that, it didn't work, because people own land in Second Life, and there's something called 3D spam, which means somebody will leave a box with advertising in your backyard. You don't want it there. So anytime a foreign object enters your airspace in Second Life, you have it ejected. So that meant that our satellite was being ejected, and anyone on it was like being thrown into limbo and disappearing. So I thought, oh my God, how can we get this ready for the show? You know, the minister is coming to open it. So I figured, well, let's do it backwards, because I'm basically backwards myself. Most of what I do is backwards. And we, instead of putting the people in the satellite, we said everyone's a satellite, and we make an outfit so they actually wear the satellite. So they're inside it's an avatar. The virtual world doesn't care if you're a man, a woman, or a satellite. Yeah, you're just some bits. Now, where is it? Let me just see if I can am I logged in as? It could also be Second Life, could be down. What day is it today? Wednesday, they go down for maintenance, usually. That could have been also the problem. Now, this is just the mainland. I'll just see if I can, if it shows up, if I just teleport. And you can teleport around. We'd like to have a little action for the peaceful use of outer space in Ireland in March with the Art and Design School of Dublin, where, you know, young people could wear their own satellite, make their own satellite with their own slogans, and then hover over swarms of us over Second Life, where all of the Second Life residents can look up at these swarms of satellites overhead, and then of course we can be playing our radio and sound streams and so on. And it takes this 3D world and puts it back into the world of painting. It's just sort of another relationship between media and classical art is that both are, rectangular surfaces normally in a vertical position where people project their dreams. So that painting and screens are not that different. This has a liquid crystal. A painting has a pigment. So we basically have pigments with clocks built in. So we can bring time into play. That's one of my German programmers that works with me. I have to say that I don't work alone. We're a very large team of hardworking, completely committed, crazy individuals from various walks of life, from hackers to writers to architects to designers and painters, and Heiko, also, who's with me here helping me with some of the tech, is also a member of the team. And there's a bunch of us, and we have a little lab in ZKM where we would really like in the next few years to think seriously about launching an art satellite. So over the next few days, if there's any possible interest in CubeSats or PicoSats or cooperations with satellite engineering teams, the idea that we have is to link the museums around the globe using orbit, so that when a satellite rises over Karlsruhe, like the sun, in a geocentric model, and it will send information into the ZKM, and then it will set over Karlsruhe on its way to Paris. And when it sets over Karlsruhe, the lights go out in the installation room, and we have LEDs with messages on the wall left by people via satellite. People in Karlsruhe can send messages which will be picked up by the satellite and deposited at the Beaubourg in Paris, and so on around the world, so that we kind of create a ring and use orbit itself as a sculptural material. I think it's doable. It's probably better to use a space station, an international space station, than a CubeSat, because they're not recoverable, so you're producing just orbital debris by throwing another CubeSat up there. But we would really appreciate input on this, because we think it's something, it's time, when you look at the investment people are making in space exploration, it's really time that the awareness is raised again, not only in Europe, but all over the world. And I think the awareness is being raised also by events such as this. I'm just going to basically finish there. And Heiko can show you the two-screen Bluetooth-controlled installation that's outside. And I hope that we can leave it for a couple of days. Heiko has to go back to Karlsruhe tomorrow, but I'm going to stay on because I really want to hear. When I got the list from Alexander, I realized, I have to stay. I have to stay because I really want to hear some of these other papers as well. So thank you very much, and we'll talk to you.
Australians right now are extremely interested in relating their cosmogonic world this might be a UFO that is carrying their ancestors back to Earth, or conspiracy-minded political Aboriginal Australians in the Western Desert are concerned that talks about UFO sightings might actually be surveillance mechanisms for, you know, tracking their progress in the Western Desert, which is not much progress. But the point being that there's no way to receive or to send signals if you're a Western Desert Aboriginal Australian that has any kind of prospect of being either not broken up in the atmosphere or whatever as part of your project. So what kinds, when we talk about the world, or you talk about globalization and organization, or even planetization, as some of us have spoken of this process. When you talk about organization, you know, it's really selecting for those spots on Earth that can receive and send signals.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So we're forgetting about out of the way places that don't have that capacity to participate in somewhat boring ways, and also somewhat exciting ways. If one wants to just think about how one might actually go about doing some kind of installation work in out of the way places for people to send to interact with the world that you are imagining.
That's a really good point, and it's something that I kind of skipped over due to time restraints. But as you see now, of course, there are more cell phones in the world than PCs by far. I think there's 2 billion cell phones. This is a woman in rural Pakistan who's using a cell phone that's provided for microcash from the Nobel Prize Peace winner a couple of years ago. As you see, BBC News users on handies, on cell phones, 61% of them live in Nigeria. And I've done internet projects in Uganda in 1997 and in Kabul in 2004, where I've had better, in 1997 I had better connectivity in Uganda than I did in Germany. And of course, there's a John Perry Barlow wrote about the first Ethernet hotel. I think it was in Timbuktu back in 1996. So actually, people who don't have the cash to develop petrochemical infrastructure, roads, autobahns, they have embraced telecommunications because they can't get to the next village. So it's like me being a Canadian, where I was speaking to somebody earlier, where my aunt was a telephone call on Sunday who smelled like my mother's hand cream. You know, I saw her 4 times in 17 years, but she existed, and I had a telematic relationship with her. So when you live in a region where you just simply can't hop in the car and get there, you develop a different relationship. And people who don't have the cash, who are living on $1 or $3 a day, do actually have relatively good access. I mean, of course, there's huge problems and lots to be done. There's no question there, but when it comes to participating, at least in the social construction of culture, there is a chance you can be a member of SpacePlace on your handy with a pared-down version that runs on any handy. You can become a member, you can log in, and you can upload your entries on SpacePlace if you want. So we do have this possibility. The thing is, television has turned most of us into really passive consumers of culture. We've lost this idea that culture has value if you participate in it. It's become such a consumer oriented object, you know, that. That's true. Okay.
Two more brief explanations. When you speak for your first time, maybe you would be interested, or maybe you could identify yourself. Also, there's a microphone system. And the gentleman over there normally sort of, whenever this is read, you're allowed to speak. Tomorrow there will be more people, and it might be helpful if you also use these microphones, only press the button once, and then as soon as it is red, as soon as it is red, you can speak. That will help everybody to understand each other better. Hey, Bruno.
I just had a practical question, which is, what's the URL for the
concert? Oh, good question. Actually, I guess it's on this screen. There are two. For the mobile site, it's mobile.orbit.zcom.de, and that's for your mobile phone or iPhone or whatever. This also works on the iPhone, this other version on the new iPhones, and it's just simply www.orbit.zcom.de. You can also just type in, space place as one word and Zcom in Google, and it'll take you there. If you forget all those URLs like I do, just go to Google. And the Googleization. So we have either orbitization or Googleization.
Ralf Bülow, excuse me, here. Your idea concerning an art satellite reminded me of the satellite of the Oscar series. Those are the people who came from the amateur wireless operator, the DXers, and since the early 60s, they built and launched small satellites which store and forward principal techniques. So the satellite gets information and carries this information around the world, and then he beams it back to Earth, and maybe there must be some communities in Germany, so you may try to...
What is the keyword there that I should search?
DX and satellite and Oscar.
DX satellite? Like D as in David?
Or Funk, yeah, in Germany it's Funkamateur.
Funkamateur, yeah, yeah.
I think the international name is DX.
Okay, Funkamateur.
And Oscar, O-S-C-R-R.
Okay.
And this was a satellite series, and I dimly remember there was also a commercial phone set system, the Global Star, which used store and forward.
Uh-huh.
So the idea...
And this is back in the 70s? 70s?
No, 90s.
90s, okay.
But the best idea would to call those Oscar people.
Oh, thank you very much. That's really helpful. There's an awful lot of interest in issues of space in the art communities. I find it's bottomless pit. I mean, I have 430 entries in here, but that's just the tip of the iceberg.
I was interested in your Second Life project where you create. Costume that's a satellite for the characters, and from what I was seeing up there, the character, the avatar, would be floating above the landscape, right? So how do other characters interact with the satellite that's floating up there?
Well, okay, that satellite, right now it's scripted, so you, in your undershirt, the avatar is basically just a Second Life avatar wearing an undershirt, and inside the undershirt is a script that allows us to type in an altitude in the chat window. If we type in 180, it does 180 meters, and it's scripted to then find any blockades, because people in Second Life sometimes build these no airspace entry blocks. So we actually skirt around them. And then we have an automatic login as well, which Second Life doesn't like so much, but we found a way just to simply log in, and I don't have to sit there on the computer and keep it logged in the whole time. It's not against the law or anything, but it's good to know a little bit about Linux and lib Second Life and things like this. And then when you're in your satellite, you can just talk to your friends like anybody else. Just the way you just open your friends and click, join a group or chat with them or send them files or whatever. You're just basically inside there. There are some avatars who wear wings. So instead of wearing wings, we just wear solar panels, and we make them big enough that it hides the body. It's a very simple kind of a Halloween costume idea. It works.
So the space thing is not, the spatial interaction is not so much a deal in Second Life, a thing in Second Life.
Well, there's a actually Second Life, because it invented something called First Life, which doesn't exist because there's only life itself. You know, so they're very clever of them to call it Second Life, because then it creates this dichotomy with something called First Life, which no one has. I mean, last I checked, I didn't have a First Life or a Second Life. And then people get all involved in this non-interesting argument about, oh, get a First Life and all of this. Second Life, the problem with what they've built in America, and we're also working on a massively collaborative multi-user 3D virtual environment for art and education at the ZCon. And this is an open source version of Second Life. Because they based it on building kind of a copy or a mimesis of First Life. And when you can fly, why do you need a roof on a building? You know? Why do you want to bang into walls with lag on the internet to get out of a building? Why does that have to look like concrete? Why do I have to generate the same mistakes we made the first time around? And so they had all these people doing buildings, so it looks like kind of the real estate will exist there next year. Like when you drive by a development and you see the nice watercolors of the condominiums that are going to be there in Florida next year. It kind of looks like that. And no one wants that, and then they go once, and then they don't log in again because there's nobody there. Second Life is about event architecture. And there's a very wonderful architect named Peter Eisenman who's written about this, and Bernd Tschumi, the Swiss architect. And architecture as event. You know, in German, Heidegger wrote about the verb to be very decisively, and you know, ich bin, which means I am, means I build in old German. So du bist means you build. And the term for us is dwell, you know, like cave dwellers. But we left that behind, and even the Germans have forgotten that the word ich bin means I am dwelling, you know? And so to dwell means to be with other avatars and have things going on that makes you want to go there, the same reason you check your email or the same reason that you go into a chat room. I don't want to go there to see some neutron-bombed buildings on a desert landscape that looks like downtown Cincinnati. I'm just not interested. And so they've done this sort of quick 3D building, and it's a mistake. And we'd like to do it from scratch and do it right with students from European countries and build a kind of open source you know, virtual environment for study. Wonderful when a professor or when Dr. Dick can't be here, where students can go and enjoy his lecture in 3D and, you know, call up a friend from Brazil and say, hey, listen, you know, Dr. Dick is going to be talking about the history of science and the culture of space. Wow, I want to be there, but I don't want to use the jet fuel to fly there and I can't afford to go anyways. So why not use event architecture in a 3D virtual environment? There's certainly lots to do in the ZCon, and we try to generate teams and create partnerships with people, and so that's that's
any further questions? Because if not, we should, oh yes.
Yeah, what you are presenting is so interesting that what I'm going to say would probably make me sound like a bore, but there is a statement that you quoted from Santillana that I believe is grossly in error. Because even though astronomy for hundreds of years, from Ptolemy on, had been taken not as telling us the truth about the heavens, but simply as coming up with mathematical arrangements so we could predict the positions of the planets, the crime of Copernicus and Galileo was to insist that astronomy should tell us the truth about what the heavens were like. Osiander added a preface to Copernicus' book, saying that this was just one more mathematical technique, it wasn't meant to tell us about the truth, but it's contradicted by the text. Mm-hmm. And Galileo definitely did this. And in the book that is quoted there, it's not an artistic recreation, although it is very artistic in many ways, but actually it's a defense of the Copernican view that it is truth, although a veiled defense. The main character, that is the one that represents Galileo, Salviati, keeps saying every so often, but It's not that I believe these things. I'm just presenting them for the readers to make up their own minds.
Right.
But definitely, he reviews all the evidence on astronomy, from physics, and from common sense, concludes that all the evidence is against the motion of the Earth, and then in a simple, it's just in two pages, demonstrates that all this evidence actually begs the question, the very presentation of it, right, against the idea that the Earth moves. So it is a theoretical work defending the idea that the Earth moves and that it is the truth.
Yeah, that's probably, I didn't really say where the quote began and ended. You're absolutely right. And actually, those you're criticizing, and I accepted wonderfully, that you're criticizing my personal...
Santillana.
Yeah, you're criticizing what I was personally saying. That was not, the quote from De Santillana begins with, mathematics was rated at the time as a thing for technicians. That's the only quote. The rest of the words, and I accepted your point of view, were my own.
Well,
that I was just basically trying to make the point that it's strange that that the Pope considered that the scientific observations were just pure hypothesis and no threat to divinity or to the divine knowledge. That it's just mathematics. It's like a card game. Nothing. They didn't take it that seriously. But when he made sort of a polemical play with Salviati and Salgredo and Simplicio, he took that. He saw himself in Simplicio and got very upset. This character was like the Pope. And I was trying to make the point that it was because it was a media text, and I just quoted De Santillana there, just to make the point that it wasn't so much what Galileo was actually trying to prove from a, how do you say, a pragmatic point of view or a scientific point of view. It was more the rhetoric that got him in trouble. His use of rhetoric.
Well, Galileo had been told not to defend the hypothesis any longer.
Right.
The Pope kept things from getting worse for Galileo because he was a friend of Galileo's.
Right.
But in the dialogue, the characters, and this is the artistic part, Salviati has the connotations of being the savior, Sagredo, sacred, and is what the church should believe about these matters, and then Simplicio, which represents the Aristotelians, is the simple-minded idiot. And then at some point towards the end, the Galileo put in Simplicio's mouth some words that the Pope had told Galileo, and that made the Pope very mad, so he didn't protect Galileo anymore.
Right. So it was more like a dialogue and a play. And the only quote I have from De Santillana is that he said that mathematics was rated at the time.
So
as
I
a
should
thing.
Be mad at him. Then.
And no, you should be mad at me. That's correct. Because the rest of what I said was my thinking. And that's as I said at the beginning of this talk, there are many people here. I'm really looking forward to your talks because I'm just coming at it from the periphery of the arts and not really from the what's clear to me, kind of a deep study of the subject. So I appreciate that.